Okay, welcome back, guys. So I think we can cap the lecture off with one more part here, one more section, and hopefully it's not too long. We'll see how it goes. I always think it's going to be like 10 minutes, always ends up being 30 minutes. Maybe we can meet somewhere in between this time. So what did we look at last time? Well, we're looking at the MG1Q, and we're trying to derive, an expression, a formula, for the expected number of jobs in the system. And we're able to do that using this embedded Markov chain approach. And, you know, the derivation, I made a ton of errors. Hopefully you can follow along with it. You know, I apologize for the errors. It's just algebra stuff, though, at the end of the day. And what we learned from the analysis is, first of all, we can arrive at a closed form expression for the expected number of jobs in the system. And we only need to know two things about the service time distribution. We just have to know the mean of the service time distribution, and we need to know the variance. Okay, well, that's good news. Why is that good news? Well, just think how you'd apply this knowledge. So maybe you run a system, or maybe, you know, any kind of single server system, and you have data available to you. You can see, okay, it took so long to process this job, it took so long to process this job. Could be a computer system, could be manufacturing, could be a retail store, for all I care. And you have all that data. Okay, it took 5 seconds to process this person, 3 seconds here, you know, an hour on this one. You have access to that data. Well, then you might ask yourself, well, what is actually the service time distribution? Well, that can be a complicated question, right? There's some statistical methods out there. This is, you know, the best fit. Turns out it's close to exponential. Turns out it's Pareto. Turns out it's uniform. Turns out it's constant. Probably not the case, though. It probably isn't, you know, a solid distribution that's well known that exactly fits your real world distribution. But that's not a problem, because you don't actually need to know what the underlying distribution itself is. All you need to know is the mean, the average, and the variance. And you can calculate those things empirically quite easily. So imagine I told you, well, okay, we're dealing with a distribution. The mean is 1 and the variance is 3. Well, there's an infinite number of distributions that fit that criteria, but I don't care which one my underlying distribution is. All I need to know is the mean and the variance in order to calculate the expected number of jobs in the system. Okay, well, that's pretty cool. And the derivation itself was kind of cool. Remember, we got to that step where we had that formula, we took expectations of both sides, and no new information fell out. But when we squared both sides, then took expectations, you know, a whole bunch of new information fell out of it. So it's kind of a cool little trick that you might use moving forward. In fact, I used that trick in my master's. I saw like a lecture very similar to this. I'm like, well, that's weird. I didn't know you could do that. I was deriving a formula in my master's thesis. And to this day, it's my most highly cited paper. So yeah, these tricks do pay off sometimes. Okay, so that's how you might use this formula in the real world. How might you use this formula in this course? Well, you know, I'm going to give you questions, probably. Check out the fourth assignment if you haven't yet, question number 2, where I'm going to give you some kind of service distribution. It's not going to be exponential. If it was exponential, we could just use an MM1Q. But we're going to have to use this formula in some way. So we're going to need to arrive at the variance and expectation for the service time distribution. But before we get into that, or maybe we won't get into that, we'll see. Let's just see some basic examples. So at the very beginning of this course, I think it was even in the first lecture, I posed a system to you where jobs arrive following a Poisson process, essentially, and they get processed every, you know, deterministic number of seconds. So what I'm really getting at is, what's the expected number of jobs in an MD1Q? So again, jobs are going to arrive following a Poisson process with rate lambda, pretty straightforward, same thing as always. And jobs are going to be processed deterministically, meaning like clockwork. There's no randomness involved. And what's their processing time? Well, it's going to be 1 over mu. So it's always going to take 1 over mu, time units to process a job. There's absolutely no randomness involved. So what's the expected number of jobs in an MD1Q? Well, well, can we arrive at that easily? Well, yeah, remember, this is MG1 over here. That G means it's a completely general distribution, meaning the service time distribution, you know, it could be something crazy that, you know, you have to like interpolate statistically. There's no real mathematical known distribution that fits it, or it could be a something simple like the degenerate distribution or deterministic distribution, meaning constant service times. So an MD1Q is an MG1Q, because an MG1Q, you know, we just have Markovian arrivals, the jobs arrive following the Poisson process, and the jobs get processed deterministically. Okay, so what does this equal? Well, we're going to use this formula here. Well, how do we use this formula? Well, we just have to figure out the mean of this distribution and the variance, and we'll copy it in. Okay, well, the mean is 1 over mu. Okay, so we still have rho. Rho still equals lambda over mu plus rho squared plus lambda times the variance. What's the variance of a deterministic distribution? Well, if everything acts like clockwork, there is no variance. Meaning what? Meaning that is zero. The variance of this distribution is zero, so that term completely cancels out. Get something like this. So we can completely cancel that term out, or just, you know, remove it. And now, for free, you know, it's not super clear how you'd actually analyze this system. I mean, there are other ways to do it, but, you know, it's not like you could look at that formula and be like, oh yeah, obviously, that's the expected number of jobs in an MD1Q. But because we analyze the MG1Q, we get this for free. Okay, so that's the MD1Q. We get that for free now. What about something like an M1Q? Well, we know what the expected number of jobs in an MM1Q is. But what's something you might want to do, something you might want to check, if you were these two fellows and you just derived this formula over here? You look at it and you're like, yeah, it looks right. I mean, there's no unit mismatches anywhere. You know, it makes sense that it would be dependent on the variance. Oh, let's take a side note here. Remember, I had you run those simulations, maybe in assignment one, earlier on in the course. And one of the main takeaways I wanted you to get from that was the greater the variance in the system, the worse the performance. Well, look here. The higher the variance in the underlying distribution, the higher the expected number of jobs in the system is going to be, which in turn means the higher the response time is, expected response time, meaning the worse the performance. So that result that we saw empirically through our simulations, you know, higher variance, worse performance, we see analytically right here. If we have a high variance distribution underlying our job service times, we're going to have a high response time. Okay, so where was it? Oh, yeah. For these two guys, we just derived this formula here. What do we want to check? Well, we know the expected number of jobs in an MM1Q is this. N, and I'll subscript it MM1. Uh-oh, I got my phone right next to the laptop, so you might hear me get text messages. I'm super popular, so I better turn that off before it becomes really annoying. No, I'll just throw it over there. So we know what this equals, or I know what it equals, you should know what it equals. This equals 1 over, sorry, maybe I don't know what it equals, this is lambda over mu minus lambda, or another way that we write that is rho over 1 minus rho. And you can do the algebra, both those things check out, but we know for sure that that's what the expected number of jobs in an MM1Q is. We know that from our Markov chain analysis. Everything's exponential here, so we can analyze the Markov chain. But we want to check, does this formula agree with previous analysis? Does this formula reduce, or I should say not reduce, but maybe simplify to this formula when I throw in the exponential distribution for the service times over here? Well, let's try it out. So the expected number of jobs in the system for the MG1Q, when I have exponentially distributed service times, I'm just going to write this out. Well, it's this Polachek-Kinchin formula. And I get lambda squared times the variance of the service time distribution. Well, if it's exponentially distributed, we get this, the variance of x, if x is exponentially distributed with rate lambda, equals 1 over lambda squared. What I do there? You got what I was saying, but, you know. If x is exponentially distributed, then the variance equals 1 over lambda squared, where lambda is the rate of the random variable x. Okay, so does that mean the variance over here is just going to be divided by lambda squared? Not quite. I remember making that mistake when I first saw it, because remember, the rate for the service time distribution here is mu. So we're going to divide this by the variance of that, which is mu squared. Remember, service times are exponentially distributed with rate mu, so the variance of the service times is mu squared. Okay. So divide lambda squared by mu squared. What's another way I can write that? Yeah, you got it. Lambda squared over mu squared, that's just rho squared. Okay, over that. So that's just me subbing in the variance. And from here, it's just algebra, just plug and play type of stuff. So what do we get? We'll have 2 rho 1 minus rho plus 2 rho squared over 2 1 minus rho. Do some algebra. Well, I'm going to get 2 rho minus 2 rho squared, but I have a plus 2 rho squared, so that's going to cancel out. That essentially cancels out there. So I get 2 rho over 2 1 minus rho, but you guys are all geniuses. You can see immediately that we get something like this. Well, that must have been really, really satisfying for these two guys that figured this out, and kind of stress relieving too, because like, okay, there's one sanity check down. It agrees. And, you know, it's always good to check that our new mathematical results actually agree with the old ones. Otherwise, one of the two is wrong. Okay, so like I said, we're going pretty fast through here. And maybe I'll finish with a kind of like a little exercise for you for next time, for the next lecture. But imagine I have something like this. What about an M uniform between 0 and 1, 1q. So all this means is the service times here are going to be uniformly distributed between 0 and 1. So I could say S, you know, follows the distribution uniform between 0 and 1. Okay, well, what's the expectation of S? Let's just write these things down. Expectation of S equals 0.5 by my calculations, which means mu equals 2. Okay, let's let lambda equal 1. I'm going to try to set it up so I can do this in my head, but I'm looking to the future here, and it's not looking good because I happen to remember that the variance of a uniform distribution has like a 1 over 12 in it. So We'll see how it goes. We'll see. Okay. Well, what's the variance of S? Well, if this is A and this is B, you look up on Wikipedia or any statistics textbook, the variance of a uniformly distributed random variable equals something like 1 over 12 e minus a squared. So my math's somewhat easy here, because I lucked out. I get 1 minus 0, 1 squared is 1, so I get 1 over 12. Okay, so what's the expected number of jobs in the system? Well, it's easy. I got the formula. This is a powerful formula. I just have to plug in all these values into the formula, use my calculator, or if you're really good at mental math, unlike myself, you're going to be in good shape. Okay, let's try it. I guess we could solve rho too. Rho equals 1 over 2, I guess 0.5. Okay, so I get the expected number of jobs in the system equals 0.5 plus 0.25 plus lambda squared, that's just 1. Is there a nice fraction for 1 over 12? Maybe? I'm gonna guess 0.825. Is that sounds right to me. But you know what? I'm just gonna say 1 over 12. Over 2 times 0.5. Oh, hold up. Actually, so I kind of just improv this question, and I actually kind of made the math easy for myself. Basically, as easy as I could. I mean, I still don't know that off the top of my head. Although that seems right. Isn't it like 1 over 8 is maybe like 1.2? You know what? Doesn't matter. But I get over 1 here, I believe. Wow, I have 2 times 0.5. 2 times 0.5. I can do that one in my head. Is 1. Okay. So I get 0.75 plus 1 over 12. And let's call that approximately 0.83? Maybe. See, I got this approximately, so I got my bases covered. But yeah, I think that's approximately correct. So, you know, crunch the numbers, see what comes out. But that's basically the type of question you can now answer with this MG1 formula here. As long as you can get your hands on in some way the expectation of the service time distribution and the variance of the service time distribution, you're in business. Okay. So that's all the material I want to get through today. Oh, just a note here. For the tutorials, I put a note on Piazza, asking you guys to ask me questions from the problems that I posted. And I'll make videos, like this, post them up where I do those problems, take up those problems. So if you have, you know, some questions about any of those questions on the problem set, just post it there and I'll be happy to make the video. I understand you guys, you know, you're on like quarantine right now. I'm doing these lectures. I'm sure you won't watch them until a couple of days before the exam. So I could see myself doing the tutorials like a review session if we need to kind of extend it into the exam period. But, you know, whatever, we'll take it easy. So, like I said, that's all the material I want to get through, but I'm just going to pose one question for you guys to think about, and I think I posed it at the beginning of this lecture as well, but what about policies or service disciplines, policies other than FIFO? What's FIFO? First in, first out. So I want you guys to just brainstorm. And it doesn't have to be what you think would be a good policy. Maybe you want to like really screw up your system. Maybe you want poor performance. But come up with as many other policies as you can. And I'm just going to give you a few things to think about. What if you know about job sizes in advance? So when you don't know when jobs are going to arrive, but when a job arrives to the system, you know how long it's going to take to process it. if you know that information, is that going to affect in some way how you process jobs? So what if you know job sizes? And what if you don't know job sizes? Does that affect your decision in any way? So we always seem to try to minimize the expected number of jobs in the system and the expected response time, but what about other metrics? And by other metrics, you know, it might be certain criteria like, okay, well, I don't want to minimize response time anymore, but I want 50% of jobs to experience a response time, you know, smaller than such. That could be one thing. But there's also this other notion that's floating around with systems, and you can come up with other performance metrics. I'm interested to see what you guys come up with. Leave it in the comment sections down below. But there's another kind of notion that floats around with these systems, and that's fairness. This one's interesting, because it almost becomes like you start talking to people about fairness in systems, and you start to uncover maybe some of like their political beliefs, if they're, you know, a communist, a capitalist, if they don't know what's going on at all. But I mean, fairness is very, very subjective. What I think is fair could be completely different from what you think is fair, right? If I think it's fair that I put a bunch of hard questions on the midterm and then destroy you guys, and then I'll be like, I'll just curve it later. You guys might not think that's fair. I don't think that's fair either, but I'm just giving you an example. So think, how would you measure fairness in a system? What would it mean for a system to be perfectly fair? Or what would be an extreme case of unfairness? So just some food for thought, kind of a mental experiment here. See what you guys come up with. I'll be posting the next lecture sometime this week, and we'll discuss some results about different service policies, service disciplines, and some of them are actually quite shocking, quite surprising. There's a few in there that beat first in, first out, and you're like, what? Why? That shouldn't be the case. Anyways, we'll get into that in just a few days here, but yeah, come up with these policies and condition. Okay, this one would be good under certain circumstances, this one would be bad under other circumstances. Like I said, just an exercise. Thank you very much for your attention. I'll catch you in the next lecture.